the right terms. I mean, we'll call him Father because we have to compare him to something. We can't just have this concept of God that makes sense. We have to have comparisons. And today, when we're talking about this glory, we need to go back to that story of Moses first and remember that that meeting with God, that simple meeting with God, where one man meets with God on a mountain and God is not fully revealed yet, and yet his face showing so much that when he goes back to his people, he's got to cover it. And he veils his face. There's another veil in Scripture that we're talking about today. It's the veil when Jesus was on the cross. Now we talked about how this veil was 60 to 90 foot high, 16 to 90 foot wide. And there's another dimension to this. It's a hand breadth wide. You imagine a piece of cloth this thick. I tried to look for one, obviously I didn't find one. But it's a piece of cloth that is a hand breadth wide. And this veil that we deal with on the cross is the veil in which separated us from the glory of God because it was so overpowering. It was so overpowering that if anyone ever crossed past this veil, they had to die. They had to die because God is so holy and so perfect and so amazing. Descriptor. And trying to describe this perfect God, that he protects us with a veil. When Jesus on the cross, this veil, this handbreadth wide veil, is torn from top to bottom. And what is revealed to us is more than just who God is, but instead, what is revealed is what we should be. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 1. For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house you groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling. Inasmuch as we have put on, will not be found naked. For indeed, while we were in this tent, we groaned, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal will be swallowed up by life. Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave up to us the Spirit as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are of good courage. I say and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord. Therefore, we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. The worst thing we can do on Easter Sunday is this. We can leave a story of Jesus and say, let's look at Jesus. That's a neat story. Let's keep it over there. The best thing we can do is we can look at the story of Jesus and realize it's more than we will ever understand. It's more than we can describe. Because we can't understand to begin with how Christ is man. 100%. And God, 100%. Much less how Christ can take on our sin and produce something completely different. Produce through our sin this righteousness that is to be shared for all men. But neither could we understand a veil that separated us from God. But what happened when people actually saw God is kind of interesting. You would think at the moment you saw God, you would just blah, 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 on about God, and it would be all about God, and everything on your mind would be God. And that it would be a great Bible so we won't skip to it. But what happens is people see the face of God. That veil is torn down, and what happens? People see themselves. When Isaiah the prophet comes before God, he says, I am unclean. And what happens? When we see Christ on the cross, we get to see God. We get to see God talking to us about something that we can't understand. He's sitting there telling all his disciples, he says, I'm going to rise again. And he tells them, and they're like, yeah, Jesus, whatever you're talking about, that sounds good. And we figure out later, they had no idea what was going on. Jesus rises on the third day, and the men don't even show up. They went fishing. Not a joke, they were literally out fishing. The men were out fishing, the women, you know, decided to show up to prepare the body. Because it was going to be there. And Mary Magdalene finds the body of Jesus risen. And they have to go tell the men, hey, yeah, come on over here. Well, Jesus isn't here, he's risen. Because what happened was, we sit there, it's the same thing we do with God. We try to describe God. And what we do is do comparisons. We say, he's like a father. We're like children. He's like a husband. We're like the wife. And that's the only thing the Bible can do is just give us an image, a word picture that tries to get us close to what is going on. But it can't. Because is God like our fathers? In some sense, yes. But if you take that too far, it doesn't work anymore. Is he like our husband? Yes. If you take that too far, it doesn't work anymore. And so what happens is we see Christ on the cross and we no longer hear comparisons. We no longer hear comparisons and go, he's the Son of God, he's also man, he's everything, and let me explain to you how great he is, but you're going to cover your face and ignore what I'm saying. Because it overwhelms us. This is where we see God, and he's on that cross. And what does he start showing us? He says, this body becomes new. And it's not as though we look to the cross and it goes, he did that. Okay, leave it. Leave it. That's good. Let's learn about it. Let's learn about how Jesus rose on the first day of the week. He says, no, take it in. It's about you. Jesus isn't dying on the cross so he can rise again, so we can go, well, look, he did that. He's dying on the cross so we can die. He's being risen again so we can be risen. And he continues in verse 11 with this word picture of our bodies based off the image on the cross. Starting in verse 11, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest to God. And I hope that we are made manifest also in your conscience. We are not again commending ourselves to you, but are giving you an occasion to be proud of us, so that you'll have an answer for those who take pride in appearance and not in heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are sound minded, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all. Therefore, all died. And he died for all, so that they will live, might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Verse 16 continues with this. Therefore, from now on, we will never go back to the old way. He says, from now on, we recognize no one according to the flesh. Even though we had known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come. Now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. He has committed to us the word reconciliation. I hate the word reconciliation. I just want you to be fair here. It's too big a word. Too many syllables. And I'm a poor country boy, so. Reconciliation. I think it's eight. Hate it. rejoin it, bring it back. Give me a good country boy term. And the idea is, he brought us back. And it wasn't about him being on the cross and showing that he's God. It was about him being on the cross and showing us what we are. Because whenever somebody presents before God, they don't go, God is great, and ignore themselves. Their first reaction is always, God, I'm terrible. When Moses came before God the very first time before the bush, he says, you're on holy ground. Take off your shoes. And he reflects it back on Moses. And we look at that cross. We need to do the thing that so many did when they got to see God. Is realize it was more about doing something with us. It doesn't say that he died. One event, only one. He says, he died, we die. We all die. He was rejoined to God. We are rejoined to God. And the story of resurrection is so terrible in that we like to make it about Jesus and stop there. But what a waste. What a waste of his sacrifice if we say, Jesus did this, that was great. Because that wasn't his purpose. He's already God. He's sitting there in heaven at the right hand of the Father. He has no reason to come to us. He doesn't need it. He's God already. But he comes. He takes on an image that we can understand. He becomes just like us. He becomes a man. So that we can look at Christ and say, okay, he's a man. I can be a man. I got that part. I'm human. Okay. This is working for me. And then we see him on the cross and we go, well, we can do that. We can die. We all embrace the fact that one of these days, this external shell that we think is us, this human appearance that we consider ourselves, cast off. And then we look at Christ and we say, and he rose. We can't do that. Because we've gotten so stuck on this image of this being me. This physical body meaning so much to us. We work so hard to protect this physical body. And when Paul talks about it, he says, I don't even recognize you according to your body. How weird would it be if I stood up here but I looked like Ray? I was like 9 foot tall. And he was like, okay, sorry, that's how I picture Ray in my mind. I'm this short. Could you imagine that? And I just start talking to you just like normal, and everybody goes, yeah, that's fine, that's normal. No, you're like, you don't even sound like a woman. So I do today. But you can imagine this. If I show up and I look like Ray and sound like a man and everything, y'all are going to be confused. And Paul says, I don't even recognize you according to your outward appearance. And he's looking at people and he's saying, there's something more than this outward appearance. There's something more. There's this, you need to die. And then you need to be raised. And this glory of heaven he describes, he says, this body is temporary. It's junk. It's trash. Worthless. Pointless. It gets used. Goes bad. Fades away. And in comparison to our heavenly existence, it's terrible. And it's one of those where we're dealing with those again where we can't perfectly describe it because we talk about heaven and we go, it's kind of like a city of gold. I mean, that works for us, right? I mean, but none of us go, I think heaven is made of gold. You know, be gentle, it's very fragile metal. The streets are gold. Why are there streets? I was wondering what kind of cars are there. And you get this, and it's this word picture. And what it is, when the Bible's speaking that way, we have to realize there's something too great going on. Something too wonderful going on for us. And that is why we had to see a physical picture. Because in seeing Christ do this, he's setting the example. Because he takes his physical body. Whatever that was like. And now he's described almost like that story of Moses where his face is shining. Revelation describes him as beautifully magnificent. And we get that same image, you know, that Moses, that face shining where you can't even look at it. It's that bright light in your eyes. It's that comparison where we can't keep. And he says it plainly. Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection is about us repeating the process. It's about us taking his resurrection and doing it again. In each and every one of us. And how amazing it is that he guarantees us, and he says, I'm going to put a special mark with you. He guarantees that Holy Spirit. That promise, we've got the Holy Spirit, I told you, I'm going to give you that Holy Spirit. You're going to be marked. This is your guarantee. When you get to heaven, it's going to be like, well, I already knew it. I had the Holy Spirit the whole time. And he says, live that way. He says, live as though you don't look like an elf and sound like a woman. Live in such a way that you have the Spirit of God. And you're not worried about every little petty thing in your life. And you're not worried about this temporary body that's going to fade. You're worried about that soul. That soul that lasts forever. That soul where you combine with Christ. And then Christ takes this nasty beat up soul that we've been using for trampling and spitting on and sinning and doing every evil thing we can think of with. And he takes that soul. And transforms us into a body in which best he can do is compare it to like angels. That was another one of those comparisons because we just can't figure it out. It's too great, too beautiful, and too wonderful. Then in verse 20, he continues with this thought. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God. Wait. We are ambassadors for Christ, as though God. As though God were making an appeal through us, we beg you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Too often we offer an invitation, and it sounds like I'm offering an invitation, the church is offering an invitation, somebody around you is. And it's not true. None of us are allowed to offer you an invitation. We only offer an invitation as ambassadors. We only offer an invitation as God speaking through us. Because only God is in the business of reconciling. But how terrible is it to say Christ died on that cross? How far can I stay? Hebrews describes it this way. He says, if he sinned willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there remains no sacrifice. Because we have trampled underfoot the Son of God. That's the resurrection. The resurrection is not about looking at Christ and saying, God did something mighty here. It's about looking at Christ and saying, you want me to join you? You want me to join you? God, have you met me yet? Do you actually know me? And the invitation is not an invitation from us. It's this question. How do you respond to Christ's sacrifice? How do you respond when God says, I gave my son because I loved you? And Christ says, I give of my life freely. You can't take it from me. He's God. You can't take anything from him. He gives up his life freely. How do you respond to him? When he's already done all the work so that you can be changed from waiting on the day you die, that's the highlight, I guess. To realizing that this temporary is nothing. And waiting on that day when we get to figure out what heaven's like and be highly confused because it overwhelms us with greatness. Today, if there's anyone who is not reconciled to Christ, having believed that Jesus is Lord, confessing Him as Lord, repenting, realizing we are not worthy of what He's offered, being buried with Christ in baptism so that we can live for Him and have that hope of eternal life. Or if there's anybody who needs prayers, or anybody who wants to submit to the eldership here, we ask to come now as we sing and as we sing.
I gave my life for Thee.
Back safe again, Father. Go with us through life. Father, we ask that you forgive us of our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. All these things we ask.